Hey guys, what's up? Sandu here, back with another video. Today I have a brand new product from Theo called the K5 Pro. That is a desktop DAC and headphone amp combo. Let's check it out together and see what's inside. Okay guys, so let's unbox it and see what's inside. So we have your K5 Pro with this protective small foam. You have your usual paperwork, you have your warranty information, your quick start guide. Okay, and there is another box inside what carries a USB Type-B cable. You have a headphone adapter, you have a spare 4 silicone feet. You have your power cable and of course you have your external power brick. And that is basically what can be found inside the package. Now speaking about design and build quality, I find the K5 Pro really cool looking, futuristic even I think, so even the light around the volume pot adds a cool factor to it. The Theo and the high resolution logo of course are laser engraved directly on the metallic surface, that is really cool. Now speaking about the case, it is quite thick, it is made out of aluminium that is beautifully polished and CNC'd. I really like that besides anodizing it, Theo decided to finally sandblast it, so it will be more resistant to drops, to even to scratches. K5 Pro has a perfect size for a desktop workstation, I think. At this size and at about 450 grams, that is exactly 1 pound. Is it quite small and can be easily integrated in any desktop rig, be it at home or not. Since K5 Pro can be considered a desktop class DAC and headphone amp combo, on its back you will find 3 digital inputs, so you have a USB Type-B, coaxial and optical, and ERC line in and ERC line out. So this means that K5 Pro can be used as a DAC amp, it can be used as an amp only, or it can be used as a DAC only. I really like that. On the front you have a simple input switch and the optical coaxial is the first position. The line input is the second position, then the USB Type-B is the third position. It also offers a much needed gain switch with 3 positions, so low uses the unity gain of 0 dB that will please the IAM users. Mid gain is adding 6 decibels and the high gain is adding 10 decibels of power. The volume knob works as a one-off switch as well, so on the far right there is your headphone amp. The quarter inch headphone amp. It's really simple, just plug in an USB cable or an RCA cable, pick your input and start listening to some music. Moving on to the tech specs, Theo already introduced the world to the newest AK4493 DAC chip in the M11 DAP. It is really good and a great performing mid-tier DAC chip. They decided to use it inside the K5 Pro as well and I'm very glad they didn't go for a cheaper alternative. AK4493 is of course part of the Verita Velvet Sound architecture for a natural sound without any listening fatigue. The USB input is handled by a chip from XMOS. It is a well-performing chip and most importantly, it is very stable. I already tested multiple devices with it inside, so literally tens of devices, and for a very good reason. I still consider the XMOS to be making the best USB decoding chips of today. This chip is capable of natively decoding DSD material and PCB material up to 32 bits. What is kind of interesting is the volume wheel implementation that works in the analog domain with a digital chip, so bits of resolution will not be lost once you lower the volume down. This chip inside is an ultra low noise volume adjustment chip with a minus 180 decibels of noise. That will adjust the volume steps of 0.5 decibels. Headphone amplification is handled by an OPA 1642 GFET op-amps followed by the flagship Texas Instruments TPA6120 op-amp for the voltage amplification and current drive. Add an external power supply and K5 Pro can provide some astonishing power output for your headphones. How much more exactly are OPing 1.65 watts of power per channel in the 16 ohms or 1.5 watts of power into 32 ohms? So for this weight and for this size, the power output is impressive if you ask me. But more about it in a minute. I'm really glad Theo introduced the unity gain of 0 dB, so that is the low gain setting that should work nicely with IEMs and with very sensitive headphones. So the headphone out is also at less than 1.2 ohms, which is not that high to be concerned about. Okay guys, let's move to the sound performance, and I first connected to very sensitive IEMs to check the noise floor. I of course put the gain on the low position and post the music and push the volume to the highest setting, and I think there is absolutely zero noise whatsoever. Background, I think it's very clean as it can be. So if I am plugging the K5 Pro for my power conditioners, there is just a little bit of faint noise in the background, but it is really faint, so almost non-existing. Switching to the medium gain and to the high gain, the noise intensifies, I think, but with its power reserve. But low gain is, I think, it's really enough even to drive some desktop class headphones like the Sennheiser HD660, for example. EM users should never use more than the low gain settings. I think even multi-driver IEMs would be okay with the low gain setting. Of course, once I press the play button, the noise is nowhere to be found, and a black background will appear in front of me. I am listening to this week and the last week mostly to the Tool, and on IEMs I heard a very good liquidity, so I think the flow is very reminiscent of that of the M11 DAP from Fio. So you basically just don't want to stop from listening. The AKM Velvet sound is very obvious in the K5 Pro, so it is completely opposed to Digitus, and it's really free of any harshness, I think. What made my head turn, I think, was the slam and control of K5 head with IEMs. So if you are an avid IEM listener, it will impress you in terms of tactility, in terms of texture, and in terms of slam department. So even the Fio owns FA7 was awakened to something else, I think. So they are sound quite different on portables. They sounded much more imposing, they had a better slam, they had a deeper bass even, I think. I then used it with desktop class headphones like these ones, the Quadira 1 headphones and the Hi-Fi Maneria. These are two planar magnetic headphones, and I think this one more efficient, is this one is really inefficient. So of course the gain was set to the high position, but due to the very low sensitivity and the high impedance of these headphones, I think the noise floor can be spotted at really at close to maximum volume. So any music I would listen to, the background will always be quite silent as night. I will leave the music breathing and developing my head mostly. I resuming my listening sessions with some folk rock that I love, and with the Quadira 1, not a lot of time has passed and I'm already tapping my foot. So I think this is a sign that I really like the performance, and it's quite pleasing and engaging, I think. Quadira 1 didn't transform into something else like Fio FA7 did, so they sounded as I remember them, so very dynamic, explosives, striking without mercy when asked for. So the same medium-sized soundstage remained. I was pleased to hear this very engaging and very dynamic performance. From my point of view, I think Quadira 1 doesn't need more power than this. So at about 50% volume, I was already too loud, and at 60% it was just too loud for me. So the more I listen to K5 Pro, the more I realize it goes mostly towards this musical and engaging sound, and not towards the technical and super linear side of things. Now the Hi-Fi Maneria is a different, much bigger beast, I think. So with it the volume will sit somewhere between the 1 and 2 o'clock position, and I could go maximum up to 3 o'clock, so basically 75% of volume, for a headbang inducing and neck pain relieving performance. I think dynamics were there, I think the slam was there, so nothing sounded too crowded or too upfront. I think the area were driven pretty nicely with it, so I think K5 Pro has a lot of power, and that can be easily spotted with any headphones you plugged in. So I still had some power left on tap with Aria, and I think that is a very, very good sign since these ones are very inefficient. Now listening to my usual bass tracks reveal that it loses close to zero sub bass information, so all in all my electronica tracks sounded as impressive and as engaging as I remember them on my big rig. So with the Hi-Fi Maneria I was losing maybe around 1 or 2 decibels of sub bass information compared to my reference setup. I think mid-bass sounded linear and very defined, so very present as well. Among the best parts of K5 Pro for sure, I think. So I can't fault anything in terms of mid-bass performance. It sounds pretty clean, it sounds quite detailed and quite layered as well. So yes, I even spotted multiple layers of it. So all in all, if you care about bass, I think K5 Pro will render it nicely without overdoing it to bass head levels, I think. So the transition to the lower mid-range is done smoothly without a single drop in the frequency area, and I believe the mid-range is absolutely the best part of it, and for very good reason, since the AKM chipsets were always impressive in terms of mid-range department. So I think the vocal performance is really impressive, the pipes and the string-based instruments had a longer vibration than normal, I think, with a lower center of gravity. I even enjoyed my time listening to some acoustic music on the K5 Pro, so it's putting, I think, a small emphasis on each musical instrument, I think, and it is basically what it does best. Now, moving on to the treble region, I think K5 Pro is mostly like a chameleon, so sometimes the cymbals and the hi-hats are really detailed and are pushed really on the same level with the rest, so. And sometimes I think it rolls it just a little bit for this natural presentation. So what was clear to me is that treble intensive tracks still had a lot of presence in this area, but without being aggressive. So speaking about it, I think the aggressiveness will never be present on the K5 Pro. It just can't be spotted. Now, in terms of detail retrieval, I think it's quite good, but since K5 Pro is not boosting the subsonic treble area, you have this fake impression that it has a lower clarity and it doesn't sound as detailed. So I fired some high resolution files and some DSD material, and it showed me pretty good detail retrieval on the right music, and it can be certainly be spotted. Okay guys, moving on to the conclusion, I'm glad if you didn't forget the old customers that are still shopping for desktop class DAC and headphone amp units. And if you are still using an older E07K, E17K, E18 from FIO, I think I found your replacement. I think even FIO K3 users will see a big appeal in the K5 Pro, with its robust build quality and easy-to-like sound performance. So, build quality-wise, I think there is nothing to complain about it. It's black, it's entirely metal-made, and it looks like it's coming from the future. Sonically, I think it kicked ass with my hard-to-dive planar magnetics, and if you are an avid IEM listener, you are blessed with a unity gain at 0 dB, so that is low gain. That made really wonders with my EMs, and if you are craving for some hard-hitting slam, K5 Pro will deliver that even to multi-driver IEMs. Can you ask for more at $150? I can personally, and if you are on a low budget and if headphone listening is important to you, then I consider it basically among the best current production StudentFi DAC amp money can buy at this moment. Okay guys, I hope you enjoyed my review. My full in-depth review can be read at my website, there's a link below. Please listen to my music, be positive, and I'll see you next time. Cheers guys, bye bye!